Let them eat cake.
That's such nonsense. I would never say that.
Oh, and they say you gave Thomas Jefferson a special tour of your gardens.
Is Jefferson admiring the royal bush?
That's awful. Can't you do something?
I'm not going to acknowledge it.
The French can be fickle, and Her Majesty would do well to be more attentive. Life is getting harder for the people of France. The bread shortage is grave.
Well, there must be something the king can do to ease their sufferings. Tell the court jeweler to stop sending diamonds.
You don't need any diamonds, do you?
No.
How pretty Madame Royale is.
It's Britney, bitch.
And Iraq, everywhere like such as.
I'm supposed to be the franchise player, and we're in here talking about practice.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Out, Charlie!
Our next door neighbors are foreign countries.
I call upon all nations to do everything they can to stop these terrorist killers.
Thank you.
Now watch this drive.
I know we just hit recording. This is exactly the kind of thing we don't need, but my back's been fucked, dude. I don't have a couch in my house or any chairs.
He's chairless. He is not living at the Palace of Versailles right now.
I feel like that would be worse. Those, like, chaise lounges and chairs look incredibly uncomfortable. Like, all that guilt.
Well, that is kind of the point of the movie. It's like how being privileged and wealthy has its own set of ennui and problems.
Yeah, it's actually pretty hard, if you think about it.
Hey, listen, it is a perspective, okay?
That sure is a view that you could have.
I mean, I'm not going to deny that someone is not allowed to have mental health trials just because they're literally the most privileged and wealthy person on the face of the earth. Did you know the sun god sometimes also feels imposter syndrome?
Sometimes the sun king god has these manic episodes where he just is obsessed with keys, locks, and clocks. He goes down the 18th century equivalent of a Wikipedia rabbit hole learning about different kinds of locks and keys.
I mean, that part honestly hits so much harder now. The lock-obsessed autistic king of France. But yeah, do you want to set us up?
Let's do it. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Remember Shuffle. My name is Ben. With me, as always, is my co-host, Jordano.
Hello.
Give me a French accent. Give me a...
Hello. No.
It's Cockney.
Hello there, that's governor. Oi, I'm the Queen of France, eh? I am.
I'm the fucking state, see? And we today are discussing 2006's Marie Antoinette, directed by Sophia Coppola. And in solidarity with the women that we hear make only 77 cents on the dollar, you will be getting 77% of an episode this week. Because your two hosts are traveling for the Labor Day weekend. But I think we make up for the shortness of the episode by the fact that we have an amazing guest coming on. At the end of our last episode, after we had talked about Rome for about an hour, we asked Mike Duncan if he wanted to hang around to talk about Marie Antoinette for a little bit, because he is a self-described, and I quote, huge stan for the film. And he did, because he's a good dude. He hung around. So we're going to do a little chit-chat, Jordano and I, frame the episode a little bit, then we'll throw it off to the three of us that we recorded a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, you are going to get a Barbenheimer style back-to-back episode where we will talk about Rome and then Mary Antoinette.
And this movie has been kind of memory hold, so maybe it'd be good to just discuss a little bit about what the movie is and its reception at the time in the year of our Lord 2006.
Yeah, so this movie was made by Sophia Coppola, who has a history of making movies about wealthy and privileged women experiencing ennui, which is something we'll cover later in our theme section. She made this movie with another Coppola, Jason Schwartzman, who plays Louis XVI. And I wish she would have cast other Coppolas in the movie, too.
Who are other famous Coppolas?
We could have got maybe Nick Cage as Napoleon, maybe, you know?
Give him a whiff of grape shot.
Or wait, no. How about...
We have to steal the ideology behind the Declaration of Independence.
You don't need to heist abstract concepts.
Listen, I said I would do the movie if I could do it my way.
What else does Napoleon say? Come on, you're the guy who knows
Napoleon
things.
Quotes. It's gonna be all this fucking business school reject shit.
Yeah, true.
Success is the most convincing talker in the world. There's no way these are real.
Le succès est l'appui convaincant chose du monde.
Like, I just looked up famous quotes by Napoleon. This is the first thing. And there's like, they all belong on fucking NBA posters. Victory belongs to the most persevering. Success is the most convincing talker in the world. If you want to think done well, do it yourself. There's no way Napoleon said that.
If you want something done right, you're going to do it yourself. If you want to steal the Declaration of Independence, you gotta do it yourself.
Be like, again, Mr. Cage, you are not stealing the Declaration of Independence. You are launching the French Empire.
Oh, I feel like anyone who knows anything about the French Revolution is gonna be like, that's not what happened.
Yeah. Anyway, getting back to our beautiful film,
I kind of want to talk just briefly about its reception in the historical moment of 2006. So I remember when this came out, with almost everything on this show, there was a ton of hype around this movie because, yeah, Sofia Coppola is a talented director. She had made Lost in Translation, won an Oscar for that. This was this huge budget period piece that got unprecedented access to film on the Palace of Versailles, and it landed like a wet fart, just a total thud. But I think what was interesting about it is that it wasn't universally panned. There were people who liked it tepidly, but what I find fascinating is that this film was reviled in France, where, you know, the actual events took place. And also think, like, it's one of the first films to film this much at the Palace of Versailles. And ideologically speaking, this is a very pro-Marie Antoinette movie. It is about how, you know, even the rich people, they can have some problems. They can feel sad sometimes. They can feel bad sometimes. They can feel lonely sometimes. But it's not just rich people. It is the people at the absolute tip of the feudal hierarchy.
Yeah. And, I mean, I should also note that I did like this movie a lot. And that if you are trying to get your politics from the Marie Antoinette movie, you might be in the wrong spot.
Yeah. So some of the hate that it got was just from the real fun haters, was that the choice of music is anachronistic, and some of them wear Converse. You know, it's not accurate to a fault, is part of the really distinct style. But it is really just about how Marie Antoinette, rather than being this villainous figure who did make some very, very bad decisions in the lead up to the revolution, is just like a teenage girl. A frustrated, bored, isolated teenage girl. And this rubbed a lot of people the wrong way in France.
Yeah. Like, when you say the words to someone, Marie Antoinette, the immediate callback that your brain does is to say, oh, let them eat cake.
Classic.
This is a person who is only remembered as a historical monster. And I do think that Sofia Coppola was trying to do something to say that she was a regular shitty person. She wasn't a monstrously shitty person.
Mm-hmm.
And that women in this position were subject to being reviled by historians.
Yeah, and I mean, the movie is incredibly self-aware. I think that's what also a lot of people didn't get. I think the thing about a period piece, and especially a period piece biopic, is that they follow certain conventions and certain formula, and it involves taking yourself just way too seriously. And at least an attempt, a deliberate attempt at quote-unquote authenticity. But one of the most swagged out scenes in the whole movie is the opening scene, I think, where Kirsten Dunst is lounging, and she just dips her finger in this ostentatious 18th century cake, peels off a bit of frosting, licks it off of her finger, calling back to the let them eat cake line without actually saying it, and looks directly at the camera as if to tell the audience, hey, listen up, it's a movie, and we know it's a movie, so like, act accordingly. And I think people just could not get the message. It didn't have your classic biopic arc, really.
And I don't think that it's meant to be like a historically accurate retelling of history.
No.
It's meant to be stylized in a way that something like Master and Commander is not, right? The setting is like a tool for the style of the movie more than it's meant to inform you about French court life.
Yeah. The style of this movie is so good. This movie is a feast for the eyes in every way.
If you want to watch a single scene from the the movie, I would recommend the I Want Candy scene, in which she has a lot of treats. And this movie is, at the end of the day, about treats and yes. how great treats are, but also maybe about some of the dark side of treats.
Wait, Jordano, are you telling me you could have too much of a good thing?
You can indeed have too many treats. And if treats occupy too prominent of a place in your outlook on what you want in life, then it can be bad for your soul.
Yes. And this is something that I saw pointed out in a video essay on YouTube about the thing. Like, one of the first scenes in the movie is her at the French and Austrian border. She walks through this elaborate wooden tunnel structure that they've constructed. And she is stripped of literally everything that made her Austrian, down to her fucking dog. She's not allowed to have an Austrian dog. I'm sorry, you've been handed off as a pawn in geopolitics. To marry the king of France to make peace in your Europe happen. Also, you don't get your dog anymore. And the quid pro quo is that in exchange for shedding every connection that she had to her family, to her country, and to her goddamn pet.
And her identity.
And her identity as a person who stands on her own. She gets treats. She gets all the shoes. She gets all of the stupid, stupid hairdos that she wants.
The eel pies.
Did you notice that they had a sassy gay hairdresser in 18th century Versailles? Who's putting it up in like the 2 foot tall beehive braid thing. Mm-hmm. It's like, you've done it again.
Mademoiselle, the people, they do not have any shoes to wear. Let them wear Converse.
Yeah, so this movie is about style in a couple ways. Number one, it's about how beautiful the movie looks. And this is one where I will shout out these awesome creators on YouTube, Broey Deschanel, who pointed out that Sofia Coppola likes to use things, stuff, material objects to actually convey really emotional and pathos-laden parts of the movie. So at a certain point, Marie Antoinette has a kid, and she has another kid, and she has a third kid, and that kid dies, and rather than showing you any humans, the movie shows you portraits, and there's not a single word of dialogue spoken. It shows you a portrait with one kid, portrait with two kids, portrait with three kids, portrait with two kids. Even the revolution itself, how do you convey like the violence and the abduction of the monarchs from Versailles? You show a trashed room in Versailles, and there's not a lot of music. She's a genius at using stuff to convey more meaning, to convey emotions through inanimate things.
Yeah, so that's a great setup, I think. And now we will invite on our esteemed guest, Mike Duncan, to talk about what he likes about the movie. I am interested in hearing why you're a stand for this movie, because I saw it for the first time because of you and I loved it. I thought it was great. Because if Master and Commander can spend $80 million recreating an 18th century naval battle, then why can't we have a movie that spends like $40 million on props, on shoes and dresses and shooting on location? You know, you've heard of a no-frills movie, but have you heard of an all-frills movie?
All-frills. Yep.
Every carriage, every room, every dessert is absolutely gorgeous in this film. And in that way, it kind of reminds me of the things that Rome did so well. They're actually shooting at Versailles. Every person is in a slightly different, colorful outfit. It's just like a visual spectacle.
Yeah, so the first time I saw Marie Antoinette, I did not like it. And it was a classic case of having the wrong expectations going into it. I thought I was walking into sort of a historically robust take on Marie Antoinette and the politics of the thing and the French Revolution of the thing, and that it was going to be like a very serious work in that way. And then when I got this, like, you know, the music is obviously from the early 2000s indie rock scene.
Mm-hmm.
The whole vibe of the thing clashed with what my expectations of it were. And so the first time I walked out of it, I was like, that was a stupid movie. I hated that. Even though I love Kirsten Dunst. But then like 10 years later, somebody was like, oh, and of course you didn't have seen Marie Antoinette. And I'm like, yeah, I didn't like it. They're like, dude, you should watch it again and give it another shot. And so the second time I watched it, knowing what it was, I finished and I was like, oh man, that was actually like really great movie. That was a really great time at the movies. And then I've probably seen it 5 or 6 times since then.
Oh, wow.
And have enjoyed it more with each rewatching. I separate it mentally from my desire to see history portrayed as it was and all of this. Mm. You know, aside from the costumes again, and Marie Antoinette, you know, she's obviously a sympathetic character in this movie, and I don't consider Marie Antoinette to be a particularly sympathetic character in history.
Mm-hmm.
Even though she, basically Marie Antoinette's problem is that she gets dinged for things that I think are unfair to her, and then she doesn't get held accountable for things that were actually problematic. Like, Marie Antoinette's shoes did not bankrupt the French monarchy. You know, that did happen. When I was researching the Lafayette book, there were a lot of scurrilous pornographic tracts that were written about her that in many were quite cruel. You know, they're talking about things that she's doing to her own children, which are not, none of this is fair and is in fact very recognizable as a woman who's visible and kind of in a position of power, just getting torn to shreds by a very vicious press. But then the movie is not going to be going into the fact that she was constantly then trying to undermine the revolution and do kind of like a lot of what went wrong in the revolution is because of the advice that she was giving the king. But all that takes place after the events of the movie. So now I sit down and I watch this movie and it's just, it's great. Every single needle drop moment when it's time to play like a song to go along with what's happening, every single one of them hits so hard. They're great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was a young person in the 2000s and Sophia Coppola had way better taste in music than I did.
Oh yeah. 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 The soundtrack of this movie just whips ass. I still listen to, yeah. I listen to just the soundtrack of it.
You got The Strokes, you got Aphex Twin.
Yeah. Radio, Radio Department's in there.
Sushi and the Banshees.
Yeah. 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 There's a Gang of Four song. Hell yeah. Mm-hmm. Love this. The second time I watched it, I appreciated it and loved all of these decisions that she was making and choices that she was making, instead of being like, well, that's not really period appropriate music, which is probably what I thought the first time I saw it, because, you know, I was being a pedantic nerd about the whole thing. But yeah, the whole vibe of it, I really, really enjoyed. Like, Rip Torn as Luke the 15th. Are you kidding me? Like, how was I ever opposed to this movie and featuring Rip Torn as Louis the 15th? This is getting dangerously close to Mel Brooks, right?
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. The accents in this movie, like, it's not consistent. Nobody tries to put on an accent. Right. You got Kirsten Dunst. I don't even know what part of America she's from, but American accent. You got Rose Byrne with the Australian accent. You got Rip Torn's iconic voice. You got a few Ponzi Brits in there. It's just all over the map and it rocks.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great, great flick.
Just to give the listeners a quick plot summary. So you have Marie Antoinette, who's a Habsburg princess. She's from Austria and she becomes the Dauphine of France and is introduced to French royal life, which the film at least portrays as sort of a considerable improvement in quality of life. She goes from being like a royal to a living god. And early on, the plot is that she's an outsider in this new country. She has to get rid of her Austrian dogs and get French dogs. Mm-hmm. And then the prince won't consummate the marriage with her. And that suddenly becomes like a focus of world diplomacy. Will she be able to get her nebbish husband to have sex with her? Which I thought was a very funny mixing of a domestic issue that somehow has world geopolitical implications and stakes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's not a subplot. It's the main plot of the movie. It takes a solid hour or hour 10 of its 2-hour runtime for the marriage to be consummated.
Yeah, I believe that there are 3 incredibly awkward scenes of them in bed together just make you want to crawl out of your own skin and run away, because he's just like, okay, good night. And she's like, what am I going to do? It's like, oh my God, this is killing me.
The French prince, by the way, played by Jason Schwartzman.
Yeah, Schwartzman's Louis the 16th.
Yeah.
Of all the portrayals, I'm like, this is probably the most of what Louis the 16th was really like. Not a bad guy, but not a smart guy, just kind of doing his thing. And there was a certain, you know, there was a reticence to him in bed, whether it was a physical defect or the way that we explain these things. It was a big deal that she was not getting pregnant.
Yeah. Watching this movie, I was thinking to myself, I don't really like dating apps. I'm kind of old fashioned that way. Me and my girlfriend met through a family alliance.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We want to meet people the old fashioned way by having never met them until we run into each other at a special tent in the forest where him and his brothers are kind of like bouncing around and Rip Torn's being Rip Torn. Mm-hmm. And then when we were talking about HBO's Rome, like I have a treatment of for trying to turn the Lafayette book, Hero Two Worlds, into some kind of TV show. I kind of want to get something made at some point. It's a creative ambition of mine.
A Hero of Two Worlds, also available wherever good books are sold.
Absolutely. You can get it on audiobook. You can get it at the website that shall not be named. You can get it at your local bookstore. So I wrote a pilot and it's kind of out there because Lafayette was in this scene. Lafayette, I think maybe only appears for like a split second one time, but he's absolutely running around in this same milieu. He's one of the people at the party. Mm. And I think that my portrayal of Marie Antoinette and this social scene is going to owe a lot to Sophia Coppola's Marie Antoinette. Like when I picture them as because they're teenagers of affluence. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of what this is. This is like the OC. This is Beverly Hills 90210 kind of stuff.
This is 90210. Yeah.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah, it's like Mean Girls. There's so much tittering.
I was going to say that when I was getting ready to write the pilot, I watched Mean Girls again right before it because I kind of wanted to get that catty sort of vibe of the absolute top of the socioeconomic pillar, but they're hormonal teenagers, which is a lot of what was going on at the time. That was a big shift in what was happening in Versailles when Rip Torn dies and Jason Schwartzman becomes king, which is what happens in this movie, is that there was something that actually felt quite honest and realistic about it in a way that, you know, even if it's portraying Marie Antoinette in a very specific way, which I do like, I'm down on Marie Antoinette as a historical figure, but there is something in this movie that does make you appreciate how much, as you said, she's a demigod, but when you're a demigod, you don't get to make your own choices or your own decisions. She's a doll as much as anything else. She's being placed and moved around by forces that are far outside of her control, that she is technically the most powerful woman in France. But is she? No, obviously not. And I do think that there is something to that. And then her later parable advice that she keeps giving to Louis is a lot of it is a result of her own cloistered ignorance because she was kept far and apart from everything else and probably didn't get, you know, she wasn't a very curious person. She wasn't a very bright person. And you do get that a little bit from her too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My favorite scene in the movie, there's a scene where she sort of leans over to get a garment and someone who's showing her French court is like, oh, never lean over to grab anything. Because it would be an honor for them to lean over and give it to you. And like, you're denying them that honor. Just this sense of like, if this is what your life is like, what chance do you have that, like you said, being curious or sort of exploring the world outside of that?
Yeah, I hated that scene. It reminded me of Downton Abbey, where it's like you have the aristocrats up top and then you have the laboring working class making them comfortable. But actually, they kind of like their job. They kind of like making you the aristocrat.
Right, totally.
It.
Yeah,
it's meaningful to them.
Yeah, a big theme of Downton Abbey is definitely, isn't it so awesome that I'm a servant? That's very true. Carson's always got something to say at the end to remind everybody that it's good and noble that they're serving these people. That's really true.
And there were a few scenes that I did kind of roll my eyes at where it's like, actually, it's pretty hard to be at the top of the feudal hierarchy sometimes. Mm-hmm. Like sometimes you just want to get dressed and you're standing there naked, but there's a pecking order for who gets to dress you. And then more and more important people come in the room to help you get dressed. And you're just standing there, you're shivering. Yeah, I'm sure that's tough. How was life for a French peasant in the
1790s. Yeah, exactly. Like these are not just first world problems. These are 0.01% problems. But, you know, everybody encounters their own life. And Marie Antoinette had her own problems. And the world that she was living in was not particularly great for her. And the fact that she wasn't getting pregnant was not really her fault either, which that's as now public opinion is really turning on her. And she didn't handle that very well. Mm. So I would never be like, oh, if you want a really good, you know, are you curious about the French Revolution? You want to learn more? Definitely go watch Sophia Coppola's Marie Antoinette to give you like a really good sense of Marie Antoinette. But as a movie where Sophia Coppola is kind of exploring the themes that she wants to explore, it's like, dude, it's a low key masterpiece.
Mm, right. Yeah. I mean, I was surprised because I just watched this for the first time like yesterday. I was surprised at A, how little of the French Revolution there was. Mm-hmm. You barely see it.
Yep.
And B, just like, yeah, we didn't see her get killed. It's just her hanging out in Versailles.
Yeah. And it ends with them leaving Versailles, this place mm-hmm. that she had never felt comfortable in through the entire movie. Then mm-hmm. she's riding away on the carriage and looking back, and it's like, no, that's actually your home, and you're mm-hmm. now never going to see your home again. And so there is this thing, yeah, about like, what is home? What does home mean to us? And she'd kept herself, and because she moved out to Trianon, right? Like, she was even keeping mm-hmm. herself at arm's length through the entire movie. So as a character who had been created for us in this movie, then wistfully looking back from the carriage, like with her children, like, she was a great mother. Like, that's absolutely true. Mm-hmm. Like, we know that. It's incredibly poignant in a way that, mm-hmm. but then, yeah, you don't see her getting her head chopped off or all the other stupid things that she did over the next like 2 years. Probably, yeah, she should have gotten her head chopped off in the end. She was guilty of treason, right? She was absolutely guilty of treason.
Did she actually love gambling?
Who knows, honestly.
Okay. Yeah.
There's kind of two broad schools of thought. There's Marie Antoinette revisionists who say that every mean thing that was ever said about her was just made up and it was an exaggeration. And this is just, it's basically like we're using the National Enquirer as a primary source document for like Jennifer Aniston's biography. If you go strictly by the National Enquirer, you're going to have a very strange idea of Jennifer Aniston's life or Brad Pitt's life or Angelina Jolie's life, which are ensnarled in a little three-way love triangle that'll never die.
Yeah.
Not that I read the National Enquirer.
Listen, we all stand in line at the grocery store sometimes.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Exactly. That's where I get hip to these things. And then there's another side of it that is just like, just is going to run her down, that treats her as a true villain mm-hmm. of world history. And neither one of them is right. But actually trying to go back and pick through what's true and what's not true about the various sort of accusations against her would be a long and laborious process that I have not engaged in.
They did make a couple references to the American Revolution in this movie, which I thought was interesting because they do kind of show it as like France. I think I had sort of retconned it in my mind as being like, oh, they were helping the American democracy project. But it was like, no, they just hated England. That was the only reason for...
Yeah, that was the... Yeah, it was the stick it to the British project.
Right. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so you know what? Check out this movie if you want to see a movie about a princess doing cocaine with handsome generals. But if you want to learn about the French Revolution, you know, maybe watch a documentary or something. Or listen to the Revolutions podcast.
Maybe listen to the Revolutions. I could have sworn that's what you were about to say.
Yes.
I don't know. Find some History Channel documentary. I'm sure they'll go in. Not the guy who wrote a 55-part series that'll walk you through every piece of it. But also, like, if you want to watch a movie that should have been an even bigger taste maker of the early 2000s indie rock scene than Garden State, if you liked Garden State, you'll love Marie Antoinette.
Yeah,
that's the pitch for it. Because I do think the soundtrack is better.
Oh, Marie Antoinette, 100%. Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. We've talked about doing an episode on the Manic Pixie Dream Girl, so that's probably coming through the lens of Garden State and some other stuff. But mm-hmm. that's for another time. Once again, thank you to our guest Mike Duncan for coming on, talking about two very different historical adaptations of the 2000s.
Yes, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you very
much. Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right, we'll catch you next
time. And I think we've mixed in the plugs for the most part throughout the entire episode. But if there's anything else, you know, feel free to. Hero of Two Worlds, Sword Before the Storm, and the Revolutions Future, podcast.
Yeah, listen to the Revolutions podcast. Listen to the History of Rome. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then I'll be back. I haven't gone anywhere.
Awesome. I can't wait. Cool.
All right.
Thanks so much. Talk to you later, guys.
All good. Bye. Awesome, guys. Thanks so much. Bye.
All right, so a big thank you to Mike Duncan for talking about his insane fandom for this movie.
Yes.
What did he say, that he saw it 8 or 9 times or something?
Yeah, it's way up there.
Wow, incredible. What a fan. So take it from him, you know, if you don't trust our opinion.
When I first saw this, I thought it was kind of boring. I did not enjoy it very much. I thought it was kind of boring, and as I said in the interview with Mike Duncan, I really wanted to see a little bit more French Revolution action, but you don't.
Nerd alert.
It's something that, as I've thought about the movie and talked about the movie and then, yeah, watched a little bit of analysis on the movie, I do think that this is actually kind of a genius movie and makes me want to watch some more Sophia Coppola movies.
It's good, actually.
Yeah.
And so I will say, if you're a fan of smoking weed, this is a pretty good weed movie because it is such a visual spectacle.
Yeah. They don't smoke weed in the movie. They are all cokeheads in Versailles, it turns out.
Oh, I wanted to say, you know, you can tell a lot of, about a country by its favorite dogs.
Okay.
Then you get the French dogs, and French dogs are very floofy, sort of high maintenance, but also like hypoallergenic and smart. Mm. And then, you know, they get the English bulldog, and that's
inbred.
Inbred, ugly as shit, good at killing things.
Yeah, years ago, used to be a killing machine, now can't breathe without medical assistance. Every bulldog, little known fact, is actually on a respirator at all times.
Yeah. You have the Shiba Inu, which is Japanese.
Super kawaii, right?
Super kawaii, yeah. So getting on to the themes, Mike had to leave. He had to go watch the movie again. I thought we might talk a little bit about how this movie portrays alienation amongst wealthy and privileged women.
Mm-hmm.
And again, yeah, shout out to Broe Deschanel for their analysis, which helped our feeble male brain sort of come to appreciate these themes a bit more. But this is right in Sofia Coppola's wheelhouse, right? She has made multiple historical movies about women of privilege living in a crumbling society. She did The Beguiled, which is in the Confederacy, Marie Antoinette in Revolutionary France, and The Virgin Suicides in 1970s
Detroit. Yeah. Shout out some sort of hometown pride, Detroit, yeah. Michigan.
And they're all these rich, privileged women who have ennui and are used by the men in power as their societies are falling apart. And who better to tell us this story than someone like Sofia Coppola, whose lived experience sounds awfully familiar to that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who better to make a movie about someone accused of nepotism and, you know, a rich woman in a crumbling society?
And also someone who was scapegoated, right? The first time I remember being aware of Sofia Coppola as like a fucking child, practically, was people complaining about her ruining The Godfather 3 as a teenage actress.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Like it was her fault.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, maybe Marie Antoinette, she identifies with her. People blame her for ruining The Godfather, and people blame Marie Antoinette for ruining the concept of feudalism. You know, true feudalism has just never been done.
It's never been tried, right?
It's never been tried before.
Godfather 1 and 2, those are perfect masterpieces, right? And that's like what France was to feudalism. They were the best at it, the best in the game at this stupid, stupid system.
And so she makes this movie, I think, to portray Marie Antoinette as a human figure.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's interesting because on the one hand, as Mike said in the interview, it doesn't talk about a lot of the things that Marie Antoinette actually did wrong, but it does add a bunch of things. Gambling and cocaine, to our knowledge. Mm-hmm. So you can neither call it like a whitewash hagiography, but you also can't call it a hatchet job. It's not this stupid binary black or white, you know, is it a good person or bad person that most biopics have. It's kind of just a snapshot of a person in a particular historical moment.
Well, I think the movie is a critique of consumerism.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are shown someone who can benefit from consumerism more than anyone else, right? They have all of the money that they can buy treats like no one before. Mm-hmm. And they're given the best treats, the best dresses, the best pies, the best shoes, parties, cocaine, handsome generals.
Mm-hmm.
And all of it does leave her feeling rather unfulfilled. And if it can't make her happy, then good luck being a normal person chasing happiness with consumerism, right?
And what's the closest she comes to happiness in the movie? It's when she gets the greatest treat of them all, her pretend agricultural commune tucked in the back of the grounds of Versailles, where she gets to play farmer. I guess the equivalent in our modern consumerist society would be like, welcome to our dude ranch where you pay $10,000 a month to play cowboy or whatever, right?
Yeah, but this movie reminded me a lot of the Vanderbilt family. Mm. Who I went to the Breakers recently in Newport, and it got me, I started reading the books I could find on the Vanderbilts, and I just thought they were like, they're really interesting because they're sort of double lucky in that this is a family who only the first two generations were able to actually make money. And then every generation since then, since like the 1870s, have lost money. And I say they're doubly lucky because they had something like the equivalent to like $100 billion in 1870 America. So it's not like they had that money in Armenia, right? They had that money in a country that was going to exponentially grow economically over the next 150 years. And so even if they just made 5% a year off the money, which is an extremely conservative estimate for interest, they would have $5 billion a year to spend to just live off of the interest. And somehow they spent it all because they loved treats so much. Reading through Anderson Cooper's book on the Vanderbilts, he really gets into all the treats that they bought. And it's really exceptional. And none of them are happy. A lot of them die of like alcoholism. And it's because they're all unloved. They're all broken and unloved people whose parents didn't particularly care for them. And then they try to fill that void with buying things. And it doesn't work. And they go to Europe every summer and they try to win the America's Cup with more extravagant yachts. It's funny, like the America's Cup is a sporting tournament in which there are like three people on the planet who are rich enough to compete in, back then anyway, in the 1930s. And there's a story in there about Anderson Cooper's mother. She has run out of money at this point, Gloria Vanderbilt. And Anderson Cooper gets the job at CNN. He's her son, if you didn't know. And he tells her, hey, I got a huge raise at work. I'm going to be a newsman. And she says, oh, that's so great. And as soon as he tells her that he's making more money, he immediately regrets it because almost instantaneously, he starts getting requests to buy her things. She goes, oh, I need these Chinese paper windows. They're only $50,000 and they'll make me so happy. And eventually he relents, buys her the paper windows. And of course, 6 months later, she's asking him to store them in the basement because they just don't work for her anymore.
Brutal.
That is the fleeting effect of buying all of these treats is they will make you temporarily happy, but you will just need something new and likely something bigger in a very short amount of time. And that's, you know, the story of Marie Antoinette in this movie. But you as the audience are able to at least see the $40 million worth of treats that they spent on this movie. And I think I said this with Mike Duncan, but just in case I didn't say it, if Master and Commander can spend $80 million on recreating a French ship at the line, then this movie can spend $40 million on recreating French court, which was probably one of the most extravagant places of all time.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, that Vanderbilt story makes me so fucking mad. These people spent a fucking middle income country's yearly GDP on goddamn treats. How dare they be unhappy?
It's funny because occasionally they would go bankrupt and then they would get more money through like a probate court and they would just spend it again. They just could not help themselves.
God
and
damn.
And nobody has added to the fortune, yeah, since the 1870s. And so it's just like 100 years of losing money.
Listen, we're gonna take the remaining money. We're gonna bet on ourselves in the America's Cup. We're gonna win that cup. Boom. Back in the black, baby.
Yeah. Speaking of betting, Marie Antoinette, we asked them about gambling. I wonder what is she gambling on in 18th century France?
I imagine it needs to be something theatrical and French, but also probably needs to involve horses. So I was thinking maybe something like dressage.
Okay, yeah, she was like an Uncut Gems figure for dressage.
Prance, damn it, prance! I got a lot of money running on this.
Yeah, I want Her Majesty's figure to cover the spread. I want the mane to be over 6 inches. I want the trotting to be.
I don't know enough about gambling or horses to help you stick this punchline.
Also, by the way, can I just mention this? If Trump hasn't seen this movie, he would love it because we know, I guess, towards his passion for Kristen Stewart, that he is sort of into like a Kristen Dunst style woman. And this movie, more than any other movie I think I've ever seen, features a lot of handsome generals.
Yep.
In fact, one of the handsome generals is played by Tom Hardy, who might be one of the handsomest generals of all time.
It's true. 100%. Also, just body goals, man. Tom Hardy in Bane is why I go to the gym. We know he would like it because we've seen how he designs buildings. Everything is gilded at Versailles.
Mm-hmm.
He's queeny and catty.
Mm-hmm.
The Vicomte has been very cruel to me. Very unfair to me. I can't do a Trump for shit, but...
The Vicomte has been very unfair. Not good. No one's been treated this unfairly since Pippin the Short. The handsome generals, they're here, and they're all young guys. They've bought themselves an officer's commission from Sweden. These are big guys. And these are so many big guys, handsome generals.
These guys are big guys. They're 5'6", 5'6" and a half.
I'd hide the chambermaids when this guy comes around.
The only thing Trump might not like about the Versailles lifestyle is the food, right? A little too dainty.
Yes.
You can't get a good burger in Versailles. It's too many macarons and madeleines. True.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah. Sophia Coppola, you know, given her background, maybe she does have something to say about ennui amongst wealthy, privileged women. But she does seem to choose this figure a lot when exploring some kind of pathos in a movie.
Mm-hmm.
So what's next? I don't know. Maybe like an Ava Braun movie?
Oh, no, you know, I don't,
she was just misunderstood. She's not the monster that we say she was.
Oh no,
the Romani are subhuman. I never said that. That's ridiculous.
She shows up to the fucking eagle's nest and she's just getting bullied by all the other Nazi wives.
Yeah.
Goebbels' wife with their 8 kids is shaming her.
And they play a stroke song.
What would the best stroke song be for this?
Heart in a Cage, maybe?
The End Has No End.
Right. That'd be good.
Yeah.
Okay. So finally, I just wanted to note that a lot of criticism from this movie comes from the fact that people say it's like a woman's movie and that just relies too much on aesthetics and not a plot.
Substance. Character. Yeah,
substance.
Plot.
Character. Exactly. Yeah. Well, to those people, I would say, one, do you have the same complaints about Wes Anderson? And two, this is quickly becoming an anti-Wes Anderson podcast.
Yeah.
And two, how many guys' movies come out every year whose main substance is the aestheticization of violence?
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so instead of looking at a bunch of nice dresses, you're looking at a helicopter explode.
Yeah. Yeah. Or like, the fight choreography in John Wick 4 around the so fire, dude.
That's aesthetics. That is that is aesthetics. Exactly. Yeah. And so to aestheticize a macaron doesn't seem that much worse.
No. The macaron is real. The only real violence in our society are active shooters.
Yeah, the handsome generals are real. Tom Hardy's beautiful face is real.
Yes. All of the different rooms in Versailles with their themes, those are real.
You can visit them.
Yeah.
I cannot visit the John Wick Hotel. I cannot visit the hotel from The Raid.
Yeah, I can't visit the galaxies of the Guardians of the Galaxies universe.
And on consumerism, there is this interesting bit at the end where she has to cut back her spending and maybe even be a private citizen. And you can just see how impossibly difficult that would be for her, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you've heard about lifestyle creep, but have you heard about lifestyle creep if you've become the sun god?
Okay, the wife of the sun god.
The wife of the sun god. Kind of tough to go back to having a roommate.
I think that is also the point in the movie where it's before she started having kids, because in fairness to the movie, it shows her a lot happier once she starts having kids. Not because the movie's putting traditional gender roles and motherhood up on a pedestal or whatever, but just because once she starts having kids, she has an actual human connection that's not just finding meaning in treats. Furthermore, her stupid family back in Austria stops badgering her, because for the first 2/3 of the movie, anytime she gets a little letter from the family, it's just her mom yelling at her about why she's not pregnant yet. She has no human connection whatsoever. And the closest we see her come to happiness in the film is when she has human connection through her children, and when she withdraws from the ostentatious, consumerist, fake-ass friends world of Versailles and goes to her little fucking ranching compound in the back of Versailles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
The movie's actually pretty fucking deep, man.
The people of France are never shown in this movie.
No.
Only in the end, as part of a savage mob, are the people of France seen. And you see the way that she's alienated from people. To put on her glove is this majestic favor. Mm-hmm. To cook for her. How do you have any sort of real relationships with other people when you are a living god?
Yeah, yeah. The movie also does a hilarious bait and switch with that mob where she prostrates herself on the balcony. She bends down and she respects the people of France.
Mm-hmm.
And the pitchfork and torch wielding mob, they like lower it and they quiet it for a second. And then they like cut to them just like banging on the door again. Yeah. Like, yeah, you can't bow your way out of this one, Marie Antoinette.
Yeah. That whole like let them eat cake is the first thing you think of when you think of Marie Antoinette, right? Mm-hmm. And we don't even know if it's a real quote.
Right.
It's like a Marilyn Monroe style, if you can't handle me at my worst, then you don't deserve me at my best.
Or like any quote from Napoleon, apparently, as I learned. Yeah.
It's the one thing you know about her, and it's not something she even said. And so even though she might have actually been a bad person, she does seem to be misunderstood at some level if the one thing you know about her is something that she never said.
Yeah, 100%.
What's that Albert Einstein misattributed quote that we always get?
You miss 100% of the shots you don't take.
Yeah, exactly. Cole 45, the four don't get you, the five will, Albert Einstein. Okay, cool. So thank you so much for joining us. Sorry about the short episode, but we're also working on a couple bonus episodes, which
yes.
should be out soon.
Yeah, yeah, 100%. I'm hoping to record my shit this weekend, maybe, probably.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Yeah, I already have recorded mine. I just need to edit it, so.
Nice.
Yeah, so look out. Watch this space.
Yeah, and to anyone who commented that you want us to start a Patreon, thank you. It really makes our day. But
yeah, honestly, that is really energizing for us to read that, so thanks.
But we can't, for reasons.
We can't have a Patreon.
We don't want to be corrupted by consumerism. We don't exactly. want the Patreon to let us get treats.
What would money really allow us to have, you know?
Okay, yeah, as always, thank you so much for listening. Like, subscribe,
merci beaucoup, mes amis.
Merci beaucoup, à la prochaine.
Oui. Au revoir.